Moving on to the another important concept oriented topic, that is mechanism of concentration of the filtrate. Man excrete hypertonic urine, meaning more concentrated urine when compared to the blood. How will going to calculate the concentration here? I mean osmolarity concentration based on the solutes and the water. The blood osmolarity gradient is 300 milliosmoles per liter. You can see on one side of the board here it is osmoles per liter are the units for osmotic gradient here. Man excrete at last 4 times greater than this concentration. So man excrete hypertonic urine. In order to excrete hypertonic urine, it's not that easy as we are saying here. It needs some mechanism in order to eliminate such hypertonic urine. And if you talk about the case of here, the one which play a role here, it is counter current mechanism. In order to eliminate that, in this who play a role? The Henle's loop and vasa recta, the two limbs will play a major role in making the urine more concentrated, and the one which playing a role, the ions are the NaCl and urea. The NaCl and urea and these limbs arrangement and the flow will play a role in ultimately eliminating the higher concentrated urine. If you talk about the limbs over here, it is, this is the loop of Henle, observe it very carefully, is a loop of Henle, you know, this is a descending limb of loop of Henle and this is ascending limb of loop of Henle. And the blood vessels which run parallel to the loop of Henle, you know, is a vasa recta, where this is a descending limb of vasa recta and this is a ascending limb of vasa recta, you know well, here it is. In this is collecting duct as usual. As you come to know what happens during the urine formations, tubular secretion and selective reabsorption based on the view. Let's go with this. If you talk about here, it is in the descending limb of loop of Henle, you know, it is a permeable to water but impermeable to electrolytes, you know well it is. It doesn't allow the reabsorption of electrolytes. So water, whatever the water gets reabsorbed, that is exchanged with the ascending limb of vasa recta. You can see it very clearly, very, very clear, guys. Let me first of all explain what is this counter current mechanism. Counter is a common word. If someone says oppositely to you, will say, what are you counter acting me? Is it a counter for me? You will say that. In the same way, counter mane here opposite. Will come across the counter flow, here it is. You are observing here in the descending limb, I mean in the adjacent limbs of loop of Henle, the flow is in opposite direction. Descending limb like this, ascending limb like this. You know, this is a outer, it is a cortex region and this is outer medulla and the inner medulla. The loop of turn, hairpin turns are present in the inner medulla. So, it's very clear saying that here, the limbs of the adjacent limbs of Henle's loop and also vasa recta, in them the flow is opposite. It is very clear. See, all of you look here. So that the descending limb of loop of Henle is going like this and ascending limb like this is opposite in direction. It is opposite in direction like this. And even vasa recta also, it is descending limb, ascending limb. Mean descending limb mane the flow in both, if you consider the vasa recta and Henle's loop, the descending limb mane the flow is from the outer medulla to inner medulla. In ascending limbs of both vasa recta and Henle's loop, the flow is from inner medulla to outer medulla. I hope this is very well able to understand this point here. The flow is in opposite direction in not only the limbs of their respective limbs of Henle's loop and vasa recta and also but adjacent limbs also. Even if this is descending limb of Henle's loop, this is ascending limb of vasa recta, this is ascending limb of Henle's loop, this is descending limb of vasa recta, opposite direction, counter flow. Not only the flow is in counteraction, opposite, even the exchange is also counteract. You see that here, whatever the water gets absorbed from the descending limb of loop of Henle is entering into the vasa recta's ascending limb. Here, you know, ascending limb is permeable to electrolytes, but impermeable to water. And even we said that urea, which is absorbed from the, reabsorbed from the collecting duct, is secreting into the thin segment of ascending limb. So here ions are moving out, means these ions are exchanging with the blood vessels, counter exchange, the exchange between the limbs of vasa recta and the limbs of Henle's loop. Counter flow, opposite in directions, and counter exchange in between the loop of Henle's and the vasa recta. And coming to the case of osmolarity gradient, you can see that osmolarity gradient over here, guys. For example, if you see here in Henle's loop itself, if you see this, least bothering about the vasa recta as of for now, for just moment, for a moment here, as salts are adding and water is moving out. Obviously, the concentration increases when it's moving from outer medulla to inner medulla. I'm showing here 300 milliosmomoles per liter, 400, 600, 800, 1000. At hairpin turn, it is 1200. Maximum osmotic gradient is seen in the hairpin turn in the inner medulla. If you see here, it is. Ions are moving out and water remains there itself, because you know ascending limb is impermeable to water, as water retains there itself, but ions are moving out. So ions are leaving, water is retaining, obviously the concentration decreases. So that's why when the fluid is flowing towards the case of here, it is inner medulla to outer medulla, the concentration is decreasing. 900, 600, 400, 300, you are observing here it is. I hope you got it, guys, here. So, mean to say that here, the concentration, even in the case of vasa recta, now if you observe in the vasa recta, while I'm teaching, guys, you just keep it on a paper, put on a paper, watch it carefully, and if you understand, I mean, put on a paper and try to work out on this, it becomes helpful for you in developing the, the concept, no need to mug up, no need to mug up. When you'll mug up, if you don't know the concept, if you are a little bit doubtful, then you'll mug up. Now, no need of mugging up here. So, if you see this descending limb of vasa recta here, when he's moving from outer medulla to inner medulla, concentration is increasing. Why? Here, the ions are moving here and water is leaving out. Obviously, the concentration increases. And here, see, the water is entering and the ions are leaving here. So, obviously, the concentration decreases in the ascending limb of vasa recta when it is moving from inner medulla to outer medulla. Look, all of you, carefully in the picture. It's very, very clear that we can conclude saying that in the countercurrent mechanism, see that in the both the descending limbs of Henle's loop and in the vasa recta, the concentration is increasing when it is moving from outer medulla to inner medulla. The vice versa is true in ascending limbs. In ascending limbs, the concentration of both of Henle's loop and vasa recta, it is decreasing when it is moving from inner medulla to outer medulla. So, this type of counter flow, opposite flow, what is flowing in the Henle's loop? Renal fluid. What is flowing in the vasa recta? Blood. Because whatever it is reabsorbed, through the, I told you that is a medullary interstitial fluid. Through the interstitial fluid, it enters into the blood. Again, it gets back to our body based on our threshold levels. So, this is about the case of counter current mechanism. The flow is opposite, exchange is opposite, and is multiplying. How many times it multiply? At last, when it reaches to the case of the collecting duct, you know, collecting ducts will merge into the renal pyramids, that into pelvis, pelvis into the case of, you know, well, that's the thing called as ureters. At last, man will excrete 4 times greater than the concentration at the initial stage. Initial it is 300. At last, it went to 1200, 4 times increase. I hope it's very easy of taking this counter current exchange, counter current flow, counter current multiplier. Here it is. This makes in order at last to eliminate hypertonic urine. It is hypertonic to the blood. Blood is only 300 milliosmomoles per liter, but urine is 1200 milliosmomoles per liter. That's about the case of countercurrent mechanism. Regulation of kidney function. How the kidneys are regulated, how its function is regulated. In this, the one which play a role is the hypothalamus, the part of the brain, and which is a part of as a forebrain it is, and the heart, And even the JG cells present in the kidney will regulate the kidney function. We have throughout the body, we have osmoreceptors present in our body. These will sense, as we said from the beginning, is an ever task. Throughout the body, the osmoreceptors function is, their duty is in order to check the body fluid volume, blood volume and ionic concentration. If any imbalance in this, they are going to start their function in order to regulate, in order to balance the levels of it. And here, as I said, that hypothalamus, for example, in our body, if the water content is less, if the body fluid volume is less, blood volume is less. As water content is less, what happens is the hypothalamus secretes antidiuretic hormone ADH, or is also called as vasopressin, which is going to be released through the neurohypophysis of pituitary gland. Nothing to worry as of now. You'll better understand after another chapter of chemical control and coordination, there the hormones. So the ADH hormone is otherwise called as vasopressin. Why it's called as antidiuretic hormone? Already I said that in the case of DCT, it regulates the reabsorption of water. Based on our requirement, it gets reabsorbed. We discuss as a conditional reabsorption of Na+ and the water. So, as it is helpful for the reabsorption, it prevents diuresis. Diuresis means excess flow of water. It is a NEET 2020 question, guys. Our excess flow of urine is called as nothing but diuresis. As it's preventing diuresis, is called as antidiuretic hormone. Why it's called as vasopressin? It is going to constrict the blood vessels. As vaso, blood vessel, blood, it relates with the blood vessels. Pressing, pressing. As it's compressing the blood vessels, obviously the blood pressure increases. So it is an antidiuretic hormone, as I said, is a NEET 2020 question. Coming on to a very important mechanism called as RAS. What is that RAS? R stands for renin, A stands for angiotensin, another A stands for aldosterone. And here, when this is going to be activated, it is going to be activated actually when the glomerular flow decreases. If blood pressure is low, the flow of blood coming to the glomerulus is also decreases. Glomerular filtration rate also decreases. During that time, the ROS gets activated, guys. And when this ROS gets activated, what happens? Let's see. The liver starts secreting angiotensinogen. You learned several times the suffix gen indicates the inactive form. And this gets activated into angiotensin 1 in the presence of renin, which is secreted by JG cells of kidney. As I said, kidney is also having the regulation of this function here. Renin converts angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1, and this is converted into angiotensin 2 here, is converted into the case of angiotensin 2 in the presence of an enzyme, angiotensin converting enzyme, which is secreted by the lungs. And angiotensin 2 is a powerful vasoconstrictor. It also constricts the blood vessels, and by this the blood pressure increases, because the entire scenario is happening because the blood pressure went down. So here angiotensin 2 acts on adrenal cortex, and you know well what makes the sodium to get retained, you know well that it is sodium, and the DCT, it acts on DCT and it is going to make the sodium and water gets reabsorbed. You know, aldosterone will play a role in the reabsorption of sodium. And water is by ADH, you know well, guys, here it is. Aldosterone is called a salt retaining hormone. It is a hormone of adrenal cortex. It is a type of mineralocorticoid which is helpful for reabsorption of minerals like sodium. If sodium, obviously chlorine, you know well. So RAS, this mechanism, entire mechanism is called as RAS. Renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system, which increases the blood pressure. Because as I said, these both are vasoconstrictors. It constricts the blood vessels, so obviously blood pressure increases. If blood pressure increases, the glomerular flow and glomerular rate also, flow rate also is going to be modulated. I mean, is going to be set right. And whenever this opposite to the RAS is the atrial natriuretic factor, it is ANF or otherwise called as atrial natriuretic peptide also. When this gets activated, whenever the blood pressure is high, RAS got activated when the blood pressure is less. ANF gets activated when the blood pressure is high. So these are both are antagonistic, work oppositely. So here, atrial natriuretic factor or peptide, the name itself sounding that it is secreted by the atria of heart. That's why we said that heart is also involved in the regulation of kidney function. What it will do, it is going to lower the blood pressure, meaning it dilates the blood vessel. How? Means it prevents the reabsorption of sodium. As usual, if no sodium reabsorption, what happens here? There is no chance of this constriction of blood vessels and solutes movement, as you learned previously how they are flowing and all. So that leads to the case of the blood pressure is going to decrease by the dilation of blood vessels. So here the entire scenario, you come to know that based on the requirement, they'll ask you the question like this, guys, in the case of NEET like examinations. If you consume more amount of water, is that ADH is going to be secreted or not? No, if ADH is secreted, water gets again reabsorbed. Again, the body fluid volume, blood volume increases still. It won't secrete. So it's a conditional, based on the conditions, its secretion happens. If your intake of water is less, you need more water content in the body fluids and the blood, ADH is secreted in order to get reabsorbed. I hope you understood my words here. Renin is a single N, guys, not double N. If it double N, you'll come across this as a proteolytic enzyme present in infants. Already you learned that helpful for the digestion of the milk consumed by the infant. So this is about this mechanism of the kidney function, how the kidney's function is regulated.